To remove this sticker is necessary to apply 200 Celsius degrees and 50% air. This black protection, known as Faraday cage, prevents radio frequency interferences from outside so that it does not affect reception and generation of noise, as well as to prevent the emission of magnetic fields to the outside. Here we have the IFPmic, which is equipped with a pad to maintain the temperature and not to get too hot. We know that this circuit can be damaged by heat, and over time we have learned some tricks. To remove the shield, we can use a hot air station at 400 Celsius degrees and 50% airflow. Keep in mind that the temperature and the airflow depends on the model of the station, the temperature of your laboratory, the altitude of the city, the distance of work, and other small details. Before removing any metal shield, it's important to practice first on broken motherboards to know the working temperature of the station. We have started this long way with economic tools, and little by little we have invested money in better machines. Right now I'm using a GBC air station. To remove easily the shield, it's necessary to distribute the temperature well throughout the motherboard and then, with the help of the scalpel, make a leverage. In this way, the other circuits will not be endangered. In our YouTube channel, if you search for Mobile 1 Remove Shields, you'll see a lot of videos about this subject. After removing the shield, we use a ventilator that we bought on AliExpress to cool the motherboard. The next step is to check the device to see if it's still turning on. Although the necessary precaution must be taken when we remove the shields, because any accidental movement can cause a breakdown, such as moving some capacitor, so it is important to know it before continuing with our repair. The device turns on correctly, so we continue with our repair. Finally, we remove the last shield where the OVP protection circuit is located. This is the IFPmic or charging circuit, and we check for some moved components. For now, everything seems to be in order. If the device doesn't turn on after pressing the power button, we must measure the voltage on the button pins. Pin number 1 and 3 helps us to turn on the device. When we're making the measurements, we see that we have the correct voltage of 4.3 volts. Let's understand better the power button in this online motherboard where we have the arrangement of all the components. Pin number 1 of the button connects with the resistor R5018 and this resistor has communication with the PMIC in the pin E10. We go to the schematic diagram and this pin has the power key line. Here on the other part of the diagram we can see up close the power key always with a resistor next to it. In our case a 10k or 10k ohms resistor.